Well, welcome to another Coffee with Bruce. I'm here today with Nick McKeown. Welcome, Nick.
Thanks for having me here, Bruce. Great to see you.
Nick's joining us apparently from the Stanford campus today. We're going to talk a little bit about SDN and also about IPUs. Just in case that any of you have been living under a rock and don't know who Nick McKeown is, he's one of the founding fathers of SDN. And these days he's a senior VP at Intel. And within his remit at Intel includes this exciting new area of IPUs, or infrastructure processing units. So that's going to be the topic of today. Also by way of disclosure, Nick and I worked for the same company in a sense when I was at Nasira. Nick was one of the founders of Nasira, and we go back way, way back before that as old networking people born in the same year of the last millennium. So with that, Nick, maybe you could just give us a quick sort of historical refresher on how, from your perspective, SDN got started.
Yeah, you know, the SDN has many sort of things that led to it, many ideas, many problems that it was trying to solve. But I think there is a key essence of, in the end, when we look back, what was the problem that it was actually solving that caused the interest? And that was those who owned and operated networks were not able really to change and modify the behavior of those networks. This is a sort of a frustration of the mid-2000s. And in my own sort of Stanford role, we'd started the Clean Slate program, which had set out with the ambitious, hubris idea of how would you define the internet or design the internet if you got to start again? And the thing that really struck us is you couldn't change it, right? The architecture had been the same, the protocols, the base protocols had been the same for decades. And so it was kind of ossified and stuck. So I think this was the key problem that it was addressing. And it's not really a technical issue. It's not really a technical problem. It's a business problem and it's a business issue. And there's nothing particularly magical about separate as it was originally defined, taking the control plane out of the box and moving it up onto a conventional server and then defining a simple interface between the two. There's nothing particularly mind-blowing about that suggestion of what led to OpenFlow. But I think the key thing is there was this appetite, this hunger, feeling we're trapped, we're held in by the current structure of the industry. And those who were building the equipment were not really allowing those who were operating networks to take part in changing the behavior themselves.
Yeah, and of course, I was very fortunate to be a beneficiary of the SDN movement by getting involved with Nasira, which, you know, at least from my perspective, Nasira was the company that really made SDN into a commercial success. And I always thought that was maybe a little bit of a surprise that you know, the first successful use case of SDN was actually not doing the thing that you said, which was to make networks more programmable so much as it was to make networks virtual. I mean, were you surprised how that played out?
Oh, yeah, totally, totally. I mean, I think this is the wonderful thing about innovation, entrepreneurship, and, you know, the changes of ideas, you know, over time, is that it hardly ever works out how you originally intended. You know, the original OpenFlow idea was to provide a simple interface to enterprise switches, particularly those on college campuses, to allow researchers to be able to modify and change the control plane of their switches and routers. And so that had this expectation of an API that was a remote control mechanism into a simple switch or simple switch or router. Now, as it turned out, the very people that this was threatening to disrupt were the ones who had the most to lose, but they were the ones that needed to add this interface to the equipment. And so understandably, and maybe we were naive to this to start with, understandably, they were kind of reluctant to add the OpenFlow interface onto their boxes. So unless you happen to be a cloud service provider, like Google at the time, who chose when they saw the OpenFlow interface, say, oh, well, we're building our own networking equipment, so we can add this, that's easy, and then we can develop our own control plane to control it. Unless that's you, everyone else was struggling to figure out how they would have this external control. So as Nasira, we originally set out, as you know, with the intent of developing that external interface and controlling physical hardware. And two things became clear. One was, you couldn't build a business out of doing this because no one would let you. And the second thing was, there was actually such a crushing need to give more flexibility to those who control compute, who were doing compute virtualization. And they were saying, I create all of these tenant workloads where I have all of these VMs inside my data center. And they have to go over this network that has no idea of the fact that they're VMs. And I've got to somehow translate all my addresses into something that is going to be meaningful to these workloads. And so it was getting really, really messy. And so it was only natural, again, with hindsight, that this would morph into, well, where was a control point that you could provide an external interface? And that would be the vSwitch that was sitting inside the physical computer. Oh, and lo and behold, you could now expose an interface in software to the tenant where you could hide all of the address translation inside that, that open vSwitch initially. And so really simplify the infrastructure. And you didn't have to change any of the hardware. You could run all across the existing hardware, somewhat to the annoyance of those who were building the hardware. But that wasn't the intent. It was really just to provide a means to the data center owner to say, we'll just make it really easy for you to have that level of flexibility. And now pretty much every cloud service provider is either using that same model or develop their own that works in pretty much the same way.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. I think, you know, if we could say, where has SDN really taken off? It wasn't, you know, letting researchers do changes to enterprise switching. It was letting cloud service providers abstract the switching model so that they could automate it and you know, operate virtual networks and, you know, big virtualization of compute at scale. And I think it's one of those technologies. It's effectively ubiquitous in the cloud now.
Yeah, and you know, one of the things that became clear to me during that time was, that flexibility amongst, you know, whether it was VMware who took on the idea of network virtualization or the cloud service providers, having that flexibility, they did wondrous and crazy things that we would never have imagined, right? And, you know, this is a bit of a cliche, but this is what moving things into software does. People will do wild and crazy, inventive new ideas, some of which will succeed and some of which will fail. And the pace of innovation is so much faster once you can actually liberate it and move it up into software. And so we were kind of scratching our heads at that around about the time that network virtualization started to take off and saying, you know, if you can empower people to do things that really differentiate their infrastructure from others and what they can do with it by giving them the keys to program it for themselves. We've done that in the way that the networks were controlled, but we hadn't actually done it in the way that the individual packets were forwarded. And so it was with that in mind that I started to become sort of very intrigued and interested is how do you expose that same level of programmability, that same level of handing over the keys to the infrastructure owner, the owner of the network, so they can change the way individual packets are processed. Because I always like to say, if you can't, you know, all the network really does at the end of the day is move packets from one place to another. And if you can't influence the way that the packets are processed as they go along the way, you're not really in charge of what it's doing. So you need to expose that. And that's where the idea of the sort of the P4 and the data plane programmability came from that led to that capability in hardware. So I think that at the end of the day, you end up with this movement of the control plane up into the software that's under the control of whoever owns and operates the infrastructure, and then the ability to influence and change the forwarding behavior. Now you're in charge.
Mm-hmm. And then, of course, you know, one of the really interesting things that's now happened with this programmable forwarding is we're seeing it show up in not only switches, but also infrastructure processing units. And exactly. Like that was the topic that you and I connected over back late last year, where I had done a blog post on IPUs, essentially having only read Intel marketing material. And you very kindly pointed out that I'd missed some of the point. So maybe you could just like explain to people what's going on with IPUs, since that's part of your empire now at Intel.
So, you know, IPU, infrastructure processor unit, hopefully the name carries some of the meaning. If you're building a cloud data center today, what are you doing? You're building out a lot of equipment and a lot of compute. And then on top of that, you're providing, whether it's a virtualized or containerized ability for tenants to run their workload. Now, one of the biggest things that you fear and they fear is that their code will bring the whole thing clattering down by their code inadvertently or perhaps maliciously affecting the underlying infrastructure. Of course, there's lots of software things that you can do in order to do that. And, you know, virtualization has been extremely successful in doing this over the years. But when you're operating at that kind of scale, it's almost unfathomable to be able to sort of counter every possibility. And so the basic thinking was this: if you're running all of the tenant workload and all of the infrastructure on the same servers, on the same cores and the same CPUs, today, there isn't a means to give a physical separation, a strong enough separation, where you can say with confidence, the thing ain't going to fail. Right? However, if you can move that infrastructure code off onto a separate device that is physically separate, and in the case of the IPU, sits the other side of a PCI bus, then you can run the infrastructure code there. And then all of your servers that previously carried both will now be there for all of the tenant workload. So this is the primary role, the primary function of the IPU. You know, it's easy to look at it and say, oh, it's just a NIC, right? It's just a network interface card. It has that as its foundation, right? It has the ability to process packets as they come off the wire, deliver them to the server that it's attached to. But you can also divert them off into this infrastructure processing complex, which is a set of CPU cores sitting on the IPU device as well. So you've got the path into there, from there up into the host. And that pipeline that is programming the packets as they come off the wire, that's a programmable PISA-based pipeline that you can program in the P4 language in order to be able to determine how the packets are processed at line rate. So you should really think of it as a programmable fast pipeline, in the case of the Mount Evans, at 200 gigabits per second, and then a core complex of CPU cores that run the infrastructure.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, when I first looked at the IPU, it was tempting to sort of think of it as just another step in optimizing the performance of these functions that previously were running on the x86 server. And, you know, you look at the Mount Evans architecture, it's a very nicely optimized sort of machine for doing these kind of infrastructure functions with some crypto engines and compression and, you know, programmable switching and then a bunch of CPU cores. So it looks, you know, superficially similar to a smart NIC. But as you say, what it's really doing is it's giving you a different place to run those infrastructure functions. And it's even, I think, not just security, but even things like performance. Like, you know, I would like to claim that the VMware hypervisor is very unlikely to be crashed by a guest workload. Mm-hmm. But, you know, the idea that you can have really strong performance isolation is another thing that you can guarantee. Absolutely. If they're running on different complexes.
Yeah, absolutely. No, that's very much the truth. And, you know, so for example, Mount Evans has that ability to partition clearly from the one type of workload from another. But as soon as you've placed all of the infrastructure code into one place, you can now then partition that in a way that the tenant workload can't interfere with. So you can get that performance guarantee of the infrastructure itself. So then you can actually have, you know, more kind of real-time type of behavior and be able to provide SLAs, which are clearly very important. And given how much of the infrastructure now not only is serving up microservices, but is itself incorporating microservices for its own benefit, having that much closer to the wire with a fast connection to the outside world gives you the ability to accelerate that and accelerate the path into storage as well. So clearly RDMA and NVMe, et cetera, have proved extremely important to the cloud service providers. And then providing that accelerated path off the to and from storage is a very important part of it as well.
Yeah, that's actually another thing that kind of jumped out to me is that, you know, and it was actually Costatus Roussos from VMware pointed this out to me, that you can actually think of an IPU as like a programmable cable that sits between the CPUs and networking and storage. And so now you can build yourself a virtual server, taking pieces from a wider range of pools, rather than just saying I can carve up a single server and actually take compute from here, network from here, storage from here, and cable it all together with this kind of programmable thing in the middle that connects them all together. And so it's a pathway to, you know, sort of very flexible, composable infrastructure.
Yeah, we think of the IPU as a, you know, a very important element in the sort of the compute infrastructure that you would have in a data center or in a cloud, and that it becomes the coordinator of communication. So it's connected to the outside world, and then it's able to, then forward that data, if that's the right thing to do, directly up into the tenant workload. But it could be to another device. It could be to a machine learning processor. It could be to some other device that's local or off the storage, or it could be part of the infrastructure. So it's able to sort of multiplex and demultiplex in a very powerful way. And so it becomes the sort of the communication coordinator of a more heterogeneous compute infrastructure. And this is the way that compute is going, for sure.
Yeah, and I think, you know, the way I sort of summed it up in my most recent blog post, which hopefully you know, correctly represented your views, was that that, you know, it's becoming a strategic control point for the cloud. It's, you know, it's a new control point, and it's absolutely central to how you operate the cloud.
That's right. That's right. And so in over the next few years, we fully expect that you will see a variety of such platforms and devices. And, you know, when there's a new kind of, you know, hardware or a platform or infrastructure, one of the things that I think that we should all be concerned about and all worried about is that we end up with siloed closed ecosystems, where if you want to move code from one environment to another, you have to learn a new language, you're actually tied into a closed API or a closed programming language from one particular vendor. We're big fans at Intel of something called IPDK. And if there's anyone that's listening that's using the IPU or is thinking of the IPU, go learn about the IPDK. This is going to be a multi-company open source platform and developer kit for those who are using the IPU. Now, as you know, we developed the IPU with Google, and that was part of a sort of a multi-year close collaboration to develop it. But you'll see many companies contributing code. There will be Open vSwitch implementations that will be open source that you can run on it, but there will be many, many more that you'll see over the next few months. This is what we need. When you actually have closed ecosystems, you know, this gets to my own personal passion, but I think this is very important. Any of these closed ecosystems, it's a sort of a cynical closing down of possibility. If you can put the capability into people's hands of having open source tools, an open source platform and an ecosystem, they will do things that I and others would never imagine, because those who actually own the platform will know what they need. So if we give them the ability to do it, they will do way, way more exciting things than I could ever imagine.
Yeah. Well, look, Nick, that's a very inspiring note to end on. And I think we are running out of time here. So thank you so much for joining us today. And that's a great sort of introduction to the topic of IPUs. And I think, you know, I will encourage people to go learn more about IPDK and the open source efforts. And I just say thanks very much again for coming, and we'll catch up again soon.
Always great to have coffee. Great to see you.
All right. Cheers.
Perfect.